website is pretty,
there we go. Our website is pretty comprehensive to answer a lot of these questions. First of all, I just want to thank you and say good morning to everyone, and thank you for taking time today to attend this webinar to learn more about the State Library's grant program for the American Rescue Plan Funds. I'm Jake Spear, and I'm the director of the State Library, and today we'll be going over the grant opportunity and answering your questions. So it's been a trying year for everyone, and this grant opportunity is an opportunity to complete projects and purchase things that libraries need for the future. And I would just say, I would really encourage everyone to think big about what your library needs and apply for these grants. This is a great opportunity for libraries in Indiana. And it's also admittedly a challenge because the timeframe for spending the funds is going to be tight. We considered a variety of approaches at the State Library of how these funds could be spent. All the way from making large purchases of technology and ebooks or other things on behalf of libraries and really controlling the spending here at administrative level. But instead, we chose to put the funds directly in the hands of libraries to make purchases that best fit the needs of your library. So we really encourage you to think about what you need now and what you need moving forward, because as you'll see, from the presentation, the guidelines are pretty broad, and you're able to buy all the things that maybe you've purchased under LSTA technology grants in the past and even some additional things. But the only challenge is there is a tight time frame, roughly a year, to spend those dollars in your library. So please think big. Please apply. If you have questions or feel a little overwhelmed, please contact us. We're here to help. If you send in an application that may have issues, it's not going to be a no, we're not going to fund it. We're going to work with you as long as there is an idea that is going to work. So I really encourage you to apply and think big when you go through these applications. I'm going to turn it over to Jennifer Clifton, who is head of the Library Development Office here at the State Library. At the end of her presentation, I will introduce a few State Library staff that will be working directly on these grants and will be your contact when we go through the process. And we'll, as I said, we'll also have plenty of time for questions and answers. I would encourage you, when you have questions, to not say, is this project, this specific purchase eligible or not. Those are fine questions, but just for the interest of everyone, your specific project may not really apply to most people on the call. But if you have a broad question like that, that's fine. Again, we're all here. We have a special email address specifically for these grants that you can send in, and we'll answer those questions quickly. But again, thank you for being here today, and I'll turn it over to Jen Clifton.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. We're really excited to be able to announce these grants and get them to you. So I just wanted to explain a little bit about what's going on here at the State Library. We have a whole team working on these grants because it's more money than we've ever received at one time. So it's more than one person could take on. So our administration, our business office, and a couple of people here in our library development office will be working on these together. So any questions should go to the ARPA@library.in.gov email address, and not to any of us individually, so that we can all work on this together as a team over the next 14 months or so. So just a little bit of a background, you might be wondering, we always speak in acronyms. What does ARPA stand for? So that is the American Rescue Plan Act of 2021 that was passed back in March in response to the pandemic we've all been facing this past, 15 months, 16 months or so. So the Institute of Museum and Library Services is our federal source of funding for libraries, and they received, as part of the act, $200 million in funding. And they have turned around and re-granted $178 million of that to the state library agencies around the country and territories. So every state got a minimum of $2 million. Here in Indiana, I think we received about 3.4, and that's the same amount that we normally receive every year for LSTA. So it's quite a stimulus for us, and we're really hoping to get that out to you in ways that it'll be best spent. So these are going to be very similar to our LST grants if you've ever received or applied for one of those before, but this is a one-time occurrence. We're only gonna have this funding once and it has to be spent by next year. So we're trying to get it out quickly and it won't be coming back again. So don't rely on things like this in the future. And we are planning to re-grant most of what we receive to public and academic libraries. And then we'll do some initiatives statewide and also be working with the institutional libraries. We're just trying to spread it all around, not keep it here at ISL. So I just wanted to share this quote from Crosby Kemper, who's the director of IMLS currently. It kind of explains what the need for the funding is in libraries. Libraries provide access to health, job, educational, and unemployment resources. And this funding can really help with that, especially in communities that were already vulnerable. So I'll start out by discussing who's eligible. I think everybody here is a public library director or someone who works with the director in a public library. So if you're here, you're eligible. We'll also be opening it up to academic libraries, special libraries, as long as they meet eligibility requirements. And if you have any questions about those, like if you work for another library or aware of another library in your town, feel free to reach out to us directly about those. We'll also be giving some grants to library consortiums or supporting organizations. So I think we'll be working with MCLS and PALME and helping them meet any needs that they foresee. These grants are not, unlike our LSTA grants, we're not opening these up to school libraries because from what we understand through the Department of Education, they have their own source of funding. This is really for the libraries that don't. So here is a semi-comprehensive list of all the things that ARPA funds can be requested for. So we'll start over on the left, technology. Just like the LSTA grant funds, you're welcome to apply for any kind of technology you need, either in response to the pandemic, like something that would have been really nice to have this past 16 months, or something that'll really help your library going forward as you reopen fully. So connectivity, networks, wireless, Wi-Fi, expanding that around your library. Meeting room upgrades. We know some of your meeting rooms might still be closed, but as they reopen, getting those outfitted so you can host productive meetings or virtual meetings or anything like that that you're not able to do yet. Automation and touch-free tech. Things that will help your staff and reduce the number of times people have to touch books or interact with patrons face-to-face, just anything that can simplify your processes. And security, we know that the way your building is being used might be different. You might have people in your parking lot using your Wi-Fi and things like that. So security is an allowable expense through these grants. Digital content, we know that for those of you who are closed over the past year, it was really helpful if you had things to provide to your patrons while they were at home. So we can pay for digital content through the length of the grant or startup fees for new services and things like that. Outreach, we know that you're interacting with your communities in different ways. If you need a vehicle or a bike to interact with people outdoors, that's an allowable grant expense. Curbside service, if you're still doing that or want to improve the way you're doing things at your library, those are eligible expenses. Locker service, if you want to make it so people can come pick up their items after hours. And homebound services, if you have those patrons who aren't quite ready to come back yet, that would be allowable. And then improving programming. So if you look at the list of eligible expenses on our website, we talk about outdoor spaces and even furniture. So this isn't an opportunity to redecorate your library or anything like that, anything aesthetic, but really being intentional about the spaces and how those look going forward. So if you need more seating or if you're doing different kinds of pod seating or dividing up your seating, that would be allowable. Purchasing screens, we had at least two libraries contact us about the potential for doing outdoor programming and movies and things like that. That would be allowable. And then, a list of other expenses. So some of you may still need PPE. That's obviously a pandemic-related expense. Consulting, if you're not even sure what you need and you need someone to come in and help you, that would be allowable, and assessments related to that. And then workforce and telehealth. So hopefully I've mentioned something that you've been thinking about, and this isn't completely comprehensive. So we're willing to, you can send in your questions about things that you're thinking about, and we'll let you know if that would be allowable or not. So now for the list of things that aren't allowable, and I hope everybody pays attention to this. Because it's federal funding, there's increased scrutiny. So we have been told by MLS, these are not meant to be used for operating support, things that you should already be budgeting for, leave those out of these grant requests. So we can't pay any staff salaries. We can't pay regular upgrades or things that you were planning to do anyway. With federal funding, there's some scrutiny related to whether or not it was necessary. So food and beverages are unallowable. Prizes and giveaways, anything that's seen as just an extra that's not really part of the grant. Pre-award expenses. Unfortunately, these grants will all go to contract through the state, and we are unable to pay for any expenses that occurred before the contract is signed. So we can't pay for any expenses that occurred over this past year. If you have new subscriptions that start after the grant, we can only pay for the part of the subscription that lasts through the end of the federal fiscal year. So that's September 30th of next year. So we're happy to pay the startup fees for a new service or the first 9 months or so, depending on when your contract is signed, but your library will need to pick up the rest of that contract. We cannot pay for anything construction related. So if someone needs to come in and tear down a wall or dig a trench behind your library, we can't pay for that. That's a federal requirement. And then we obviously can't pay for lobbying or advocacy. Travel for these grants isn't going to be a necessary expense. This should all be things occurring in your library. So travel won't be an allowable expense for that. We can't provide grants for you to re-grant to other organizations. I don't think any of you would do that, but we'll just have that upfront. Fundraising, you can't use the grant funds to hold fundraisers to get more funding. That's not what these grants are for. And then professional development. The State Library has set some aside for professional development, and we'll be coming out with a plan over the next year for how to do that best statewide. You're welcome to apply for individual professional development for your staff, but it does have to be related to COVID-19 or recovery. It can't just be general professional development that you would have done anyway. And then finally, anything not related to pandemic relief and recovery. When you submit your application, there has to be some kind of tie to how these are rescue funds and how these will benefit your community. So I know you've all been waiting since March to find out when these grants would be available. And we've gotten a lot of questions, and we know that there's been some frustration. Some of you have been wondering, why has it taken so long? You know, we're still kind of in the throes of the pandemic, and you could really use this funding now. Well, it took a little bit of time for ISL to plan how we'll be spending the funds. And then after that, we had to get everything approved by our state budget agency. And from what I understand, it's still not completely 100% approved. So, you know, we've been working as fast as we can for being government employees, but I think we're finally ready at this point. I know some people are frustrated that they can't request reimbursement for things that they've already purchased. And we understand, we know with the CARES grants, it was kind of unique that you could submit receipts, but those were smaller grants. And for the size of these grants, we really need to go to contract, and with contract, we're limited for the dates. Some of you may have colleagues in other states where every library received a portion of the funding. And you might be wondering, why didn't we just send the funding to the libraries? And here in Indiana, we're required to treat these as reimbursement grants. So we need to see what was purchased before we can release the funds. So it's just a little bit of an additional oversight required by our state. Some have kind of questioned, like, why do we have to limit these to pandemic relief? Can we do something else or upgrade something else? It's provided as part of that that national act. So we really need to stick with that. And we do have oversight, not only from the state, but when we report back to IMLS how we spent this funding, it needs to be in alignment with what they told us to do with it. And then some have asked, can you share an example application or why didn't you give us more time? It's going to be really hard to apply. We'll talk about the application in a minute, but this is one of the simplest applications we've ever developed for a grant. So hopefully you'll find it easier. Before we get into how to apply, I did want to mention there may be some other sources of this funding because it was a national act, all different kinds of agencies and states receive funding in different forms. So there may be some additional funding for you through your own municipality, towns or counties. Just keep your ears open for that. And then we have been partnering with Indiana Humanities, and they have been kind enough to open one of their grants up to libraries. So I just wanted to make sure everybody was aware of that. They have grants for programming and capacity building. You can request up to $10,000 for that. And they're pretty specific about what kind of programming that entails. So programming in response to COVID or pandemics in general, getting people back to the library using humanities-based programming, or strategic planning and capacity building. So maybe you're a little bit behind in your planning, especially if it's in response to COVID. You're welcome to apply for funding through them. And their grant is open a little bit longer than ours, so you have until the end of August for that. So we'd encourage you to consider applying for both, but I will caution, we cannot provide federal funds for anything else you've already received federal funds for, so just be mindful of that. Okay, so I'll stop talking about the grants and everything, and let's get down to how to apply. So we have an ARPA website. I think Angela shared it in the chat already, and here's the link here. You can get to it from our homepage. It's over on the left menu up at the top. So we've tried to make it as easy as possible for you to find it. So before you apply, just take a look at the website. There's some FAQs. There's some good information about the grants. And then you'll see a link to the application. So our application is actually a digital application this time around. There's no like 13-page application like our LSTA funds. You can complete it via Microsoft Forms, and you'll need to do it in one sitting. So I'll caution you, it shouldn't take too long, but just be ready to complete it. You won't be able to start it and come back to it if you don't submit it. So we'll be asking for your contact information for the library director and then also the project director. So if you as the director are not managing your grant, feel free to designate who will be. We'll be asking you to give your project a title. We predict we'll probably be receiving a couple hundred, maybe 300 applications. So it would be really helpful for us if you could kind of condense what your project is with a good descriptive title. And then after that, we're asking for a brief description, just, outdoor seating for outdoor programming, something quick like that, so we know what it is at a glance. And then there will be space to provide a narrative. So that's where you can give us more information about how you determined why it was a need at your library or what you're planning to do for in more detail. Then there will be a field asking for the dollar amount requested, and that needs to be between $5,000 and $100,000. We're trying to, like Jake said, we want you to think big. We're not doing a bunch of little $200 grants. We want you to really think about what you need and then request that. There will be a field for a budget explanation. So where you can kind of explain what you're requesting and why, and how it relates to the project. And then two things I should mention that might be a stumbling block for some of you. We asked for your federal employer ID number, so you should have that. But we also need a DUNS number. And I know that can be confusing. If you've ever applied for an LST grant, you probably already have that or have access to it. If you do not have it, we have information on our website on how to obtain it. It's basically like individuals have social security numbers. It's kind of like that, an identifying number for organizations. So, and it's a federal requirement. We have to have that when we report back to IMLS what we did. And then there's a lot of additional oversight for these grants. And there's some changes on federal websites, and they're going to be actually be issuing new numbers, new SAMs, ID numbers. So to have the DUNS will really help make sure that when it's reporting time for us, that everything gets done correctly. And if you're running into a ton of trouble getting your number, just reach out to us and we can help. Okay, so once you've completed the application and forms, there's also a second component that is absolutely required. It's your project budget, and that is where you will list everything you intend to purchase, how much it costs, and what the total is. And that will become part of your grant contract. So you'll download that Excel sheet from our website, and then you'll need to email that in. We don't have the capability to do an upload to the form. So that will be kind of a second step in the application. And we'll be tracking which applications come in and what budgets come in. We'll try, if we don't get your budget and we get your application, we'll try to reach out and ask for that. But if the expiration date comes up and we don't have your full application, there's a chance we probably won't be able to consider it. I'm going to check the chat for a minute and just see if anything came in that hasn't been answered already. Okay, someone asked me directly, will there be consideration for grants that include multiple purchases that are smaller in scope? They're not related to each other, but still COVID related. I think that would be fine as long as they were all COVID related. We also have we have libraries that want to do a number of things around their building or grounds that are pandemic relief. So yeah, that would be fine. And we would encourage you to apply for one grant and not submit a few different ones for the different projects, because essentially you'll be competing with yourself, and we'll only be awarding your library one contract. So if you can just put it all together, that would help us out a lot. Okay, I think that answers Alyssa's question too. Okay, how specific do the amounts need to be? Can they be an estimate, approximate amount? Yes, they can be. Make sure they're a pretty close estimate. What we can do is we'll be awarding you funding based on the project budget category. So you'll be free to spend within that amount. If it turns out that your expenses end up being wildly different than what you budgeted for, we can revise your budget. You can send us a new copy and we'll get that on file. If you need to change your budget, if you've decided, you know, I don't want to do that after all, I'm going to do something completely different, that would need to be submitted for approval before you could do that. But it would be helpful for everyone if you could get a pretty good quote and not just apply for a large amount, just hoping to be able to cover everything.
Jen, I think the only one yes. that hasn't been answered yet is from Rachel. Are we able to request funds for installation of Wi-Fi enabled lockers? I'm working with another community member to set up lockers in the nearby area where patrons would be able to check out each the tech items. Sorry.
Okay. Thanks. Installation could be allowable if it's for a project related expense. But we do caution if there's any construction component, like if there's any permit that needs to be filed or group that needs to come out or we can't fund that. So that would need to be covered by your library.
If we're asking for something that is sole source, do we still need multiple quotes?
That might be an SBOA question. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's probably a pretty good idea to have some quotes before you apply, and definitely if it's related to SBOA, we can follow up with you individually after the presentation. Okay, I see someone asked if there might be a second round. Yes, there might be. Oh. We have no idea how much everyone is going to request. And we know in some states they've gotten double the requests for funds they have. And in other states, only half of their funds have been requested. So there is a possibility of a second round. But if so, we would be really running close to the timeline for spending. So it would have to be something really quick. Okay, someone asked why I said no public use computers. What I meant is these aren't supposed to be used for things that you would have been budgeting for anyway. So if your computers were on a 5-year schedule and you're on year 4 and you know you need new computers next year, this really isn't what the intent of the funds is for. If you have an argument for how it's pandemic related or reopening related, I guess you're welcome to apply, but it won't be seen as a compelling of a need as possibly some of the other projects. Okay, so someone's got a question about the timeline. So I'll go ahead and move on through my presentation, and we'll get to that in just a moment. I do want to talk a little bit more about the project budget because we've gotten a few questions about how to complete that so far. So this is the budget form. This is what the Excel file looks like. It's laid out similar to your own budget. So minus the personal expenses or at the top, so because we're not reimbursing for any of those. So in the first column, the budget item column, you'll list what you're requesting. So the name of the item or service. And then in source or method of computation, we're asking how did you determine the cost of the service? So the number of units and what price or the quote received, just how you came to the cost. And then the actual cost, you'll list the grant funds requested under the LSTA grant funds column. And then there is a column for cost sharing, but for these grants, unlike our LST grants, it's not required. If you are planning to pick up a portion, so for example, if you're trying a 1-year subscription to something that starts in January, and you know from our guidance that we can't cover anything that extends past the end of the grant, you can put the library's portion in that column. But again, it's not required for every project. And then you'll total those all up on the right and then at the bottom. So another question I've received is, do you have to put something in every category? And the answer is no. You only need to fill out the parts that are applicable to your project. And then we do ask you to break out all the different components. So you can add additional rows if needed to do that. It needs to be really clear what you're purchasing and how much it costs and how you determine that. Or we'll probably come back with some questions. Okay, so the timeline, you'll see coming up pretty quickly in just a little bit over 2 weeks, the applications will be due. So make sure to get those in if you're interested at all. We will be reviewing those throughout August and hopefully making some funding decisions pretty quickly after that, because we know everyone wants to get started. So we've given ourselves a 2-month window to review those. How we'll be reviewing them is based on need, how well they are related to the purposes of the grant. And it's possible, I think this question might come up, There may be partial awards. So, but if we do that, we will correspond with you and let you know what's going on and make sure that's okay with you before anything goes to contract. So after the contracts are emailed out, you'll need to complete those and return them, and then they go through the whole state process. So once they are signed by the last required signature at the state, your project can begin and you can begin making your grant expenditures. So these are reimbursement grants. So you will need to spend the money up front, but you can request reimbursement at any time. So monthly if needed. And we would encourage you to do that promptly and not just wait until the end. So we can kind of track how much each project has left. There will be some reporting requirements. They shouldn't be too extensive. We'll need a kind of an interim report just to make sure everything's going all right. And we'll have that posted to the website shortly. But we'll also, the grants will officially end on July 30th. I think it might be 31st, but at the end of July is when your project needs to wrap up. So all of your funding, all of your purchases need to be made by that date. And then we're giving you a couple of weeks to submit those final reimbursement requests so we can get you the funding that you requested. And then by September 30th of 2022, your final reports are due and everything related to the project needs to be done. So it's a pretty quick turnaround. I'm gonna check for questions again.
I think, excuse me, Jen, I think everything can be answered except for the last one from Emily.
Okay. So if we have questions about an application, will the libraries have opportunities to answer? Yes, of course, yeah. Okay, Lisa, that's another really good question. If you're thinking about buying something that you've been told is on back order or may not be available before the end of the grant, we're really limited to these dates. So you can't go ahead and jump on it now hoping to get the grant. And then if it turns out it's not available before the end of the grant, we also won't be able to pay for it then. So that's not our decision at ISL. That's kind of the federal rules paired with our state budget agency and just how the funding works here. So, and we know that certain things like anything with a chip or we know some states wanted to do bookmobile initiatives and there's a big back order for those right now. So just be mindful of that. Okay, so if you do receive a grant, if your grant is funded, you will need to complete and return the contract that will be emailed to you by our business office. And we would encourage you to do that pretty quickly. I think we just need a board signature and just review it and make sure you're okay with all the terms. But once you send that back to us with the instructions included, it can take up to 45 days after we receive it back for your grant to finally be approved, and you'll receive notification when that is. So just be aware that it takes a little bit of time. You'll need to spend according to your budget. Like I mentioned a little bit earlier, we can revise budgets if needed, but someone at the state library will need to approve that first. We will not be able to reimburse any expenses that hadn't been requested ahead of time. So please don't send any surprises in with your reimbursement request and let us know ahead of time what you're doing. You'll need to complete spending by the end of July of 2022. When you submit your reimbursement requests, and all of those will be emailed into that ARPA@library.in.gov email, you will need to provide the necessary documentation, and we'll have more information on that in your grant contract, but we need to see itemized receipts and invoices that show that things were actually purchased. So we'll try to provide a comprehensive list of things like that, but many of you received the CARES funds or are already kind of aware of what that looks like. Just stay in touch with us if there are any changes to your project, and then please help us out by completing the required reports because we have to send those into IMLS to show how well Indiana spent their money. So that is all I had prepared. So it looks like we have some time for questions. And then also, I think Jake wanted to introduce some of our grant team so that you could get to know them. These are the people who are also going to be helping answer questions and process your claims and everything.
Yes, so thanks. And please send in your questions and we'll go through that. We're gonna try to be as flexible as possible and work with you on your app, on your projects. But I just wanted to mention that we have a few staff members that will be working on this. So we have Martha Jane Ringel, who is in the business office, and she'll be working on some of the reimbursements and other things. We also have Angela Downs, who will be responding to some of your questions as far as once you have a grant application and have been sending in expenditures, she'll be one of the people responding to you. We also have Catrice Anders Jordan, who is also our CFO for the library, and she oversees our business office and some of those transactions. She's also, I believe, on the call today. And Carissa Ginsburg works in the business office. She'll be responding and working on some of those reimbursements. And of course, many of you already know Angela Fox. She's our LSTA coordinator. She's still working on our other LSTA IMLS grants, and she is still available to answer questions on these, but we're trying to give her a little bit of a break on this one since she has a full IMLS program. That's why we brought in additional staff. And also want to mention Stephanie Asbury, who is our deputy director for the library. She's, of course, available too to help with any questions that come in. I don't believe I missed anyone, but if so, I apologize. But I just wanted to mention those people and that it's all a team here, and we're really going to work hard to make this a good experience for libraries. So I think we had the questions. We can start going through some of those. You can either unmute yourself or submit them through the chat.
Okay, I see Emily Bunyan's question about hiring consultants to provide social services, unemployment application assistance. Yeah, that would be fine. That would be an eligible cost because it's a new service in response to what's happening in your community. That would be fine. Julia Aker is asking if you need to create a separate ARPA fund. I believe that's what SBOA is advising. And we'll try to put together, I've contacted them to let them know that these grants are close to being awarded, and they'll be communicating with us if there's anything you need to know about that. How would shipping be budgeted for? If it's related to the item that you're purchasing, you can just bundle it as one expenditure on our budget. You don't have to break it out into a different column. Will the slides be available? Yes, well, we'll post this recording to YouTube, and then also we can post these slides to the website. Lisa asks, this is a good question. She said that her computer services folks said that tech purchases require that patrons sign that they wouldn't have had access to this otherwise. That is a different grant. Those are the grants being offered. That's that $7 billion grant for connectivity. That's a separate offering. And I know that Haley Trefin has contacted all of you about how to apply for that separate pot of funding. But yeah, that requirement does not apply to these grants at all. Okay, thank you, Angela, for answering that. Okay, so yeah, like Jake said, I think we can go ahead and we'll try to open it up. If it gets, we might have to go back to chat if there's too many people talking at once, but please ask your questions.
If you have specific, as I said, if you have very specific project questions, we're here to answer, but if you have any other type of questions, we're here too. So we can go from there.
I wanted to add also, it was stated in the chat, but just to make sure that the claims are sent in monthly. And if you have any questions about wanting to know if you qualify, if you need to revise your budget, and we'll, if you have enough time, we'll review those on a case-by-case basis. Sometimes we will allow extensions, small extensions. So just let us know, just stay in communication with us.
When does construction become construction? So if there's a I'm thinking like an outdoor pavilion for programming. If there's sort of this pre-kit, this kit that you can purchase that that's a pavilion kit, could the kit itself be part of the grant, and we would just have to figure out how to put it together, or is that crossing a line?
That's exactly it. You're welcome to purchase the kit, but IMLS is forbidden from funding anything construction related. So once that crew comes out, that needs to be a local expenditure.
So I've heard
So it's the labor that's restricted, not the material. Is that correct? Okay.
Right. So if you bought a gazebo or pavilion, then you could purchase that with the funds. But if you hired a person, a handyman or someone to put that together, that would need to be library funds or your foundation or friends or some other source of funds. I think I've heard one definition that if it requires more than a screwdriver or one of those little widgets that come in the packet, if it requires more than that, then that's going to be considered construction. That's a general rule of thumb.
Someone had a question about installation. It doesn't have to be installed by then, but all of the services are supposed to be complete by July 30th. So if it's anything after that, we won't be able to cover it.
Yeah, we can't prepay installation or anything like that. It actually needs to be installed by the end of the grant.
So Julie asked, looking at larger purchases, like library vehicles, is it possible to include future maintenance fees into a budget we can manage after the expenditure deadline? So it's kind of like the e-resources. If you bought a warranty or something, it would have, that portion of it would have to go through the end of the grant deadline. And so anything beyond that, so a warranty that went past next July 30th or 31st would need to be library funds, but it could be eligible with the federal funds up until that date. And then would installation, and Aaron Lawrence asks, would installation of wiring for technology also fall under construction? Believe so, yes. I mean, if there's any trench digging, if there's work in your library to open walls up and put wiring, that would be construction. It's such a gray area, and it seems silly, but it almost, if you were doing other installation where they're just bringing a connection, I mean, I would submit your specific questions if there's like a project to that, but I think if it's just running cabling through wall or through like the ceiling, like laying it over, I think in some cases that would be eligible. If there's not, you know, like I said, a trench being dug outside the library, or if there's not walls being cut open or that type of thing. But if it was merely running a cable to a router in a new area of your thing, or running a cable through the ceiling to an outdoor Wi-Fi area, that I think is eligible, is my understanding. Please correct me if I'm wrong, Jen or Angela or anyone.
It's a question related to carpet versus tile. Any construction will not be included. So if you're doing tile, you have to demolish anything, it should not be included.
We could pay for the tiles, but not the actual labor.
I have a question. Jen, what is the likelihood that most of these grants are should be expected to be funded? Because the range is so large that when people start throwing in incredibly high ticketed items, you know, $50,000 for would take up 68 grants, and that's $3.4 million.
Yeah.
So before we throw all of this effort in, what should we realistically expect?
Sure. So we have no idea what to expect. We don't know how many of you are going to apply and for how much you're going to need. So we're going to kind of wait and see what comes in. And like I mentioned a little bit earlier, if we have to, we'll do our best to partially fund whatever we can without, you know, hurting the integrity of your project. We won't, you know, just half fund something that you wouldn't be able to pay for anyway or anything like that. But yeah, we just ask that you be patient with us, but we will try our best to get this money around the state. Teresa's question, I think, is pretty related to that. She said, what if part of a grant is approved? So updating media room, but not updating children's decor. Yeah, that's kind of what you could expect if something's partially funded.
No, I'll just mention again what Jen said earlier. We tried to make it as easy and simple as possible so that you could really submit a grant without you know, a huge amount of requirements or roadblocks to do that. And so we understand you're very busy and trying to make it as easy as possible. And we're going to work with you on your grant application as best we can. Well, again, this is not the end. This is just the beginning. We have the email address for you able to send in questions. You're able to call in with any questions you may have. It's kind of all hands on deck here as far as trying to get these grants out and assist libraries. You know, we'll do our very best and we'll look forward to working with you. And then we have a couple questions from Melissa. Thank you. You're right. It is difficult to figure out what we can accomplish. But yeah, again, and we really appreciate everyone working on this, and it's kind of like we're all a team, even libraries, public and academic on these. So I think we can wrap up today unless there's any really pressing questions or any concerns you may have. Well, thank you for all the kind words and thank yous, and hope everyone has a nice Friday and a good weekend. And as I said, we're here to answer your questions.
Do you know how quickly the slides will be available? Just with a tight deadline if we want to review stuff.
Yeah, I could have those up by the end of the day, I think.
That's great. Thanks.
Okay, well, that concludes it. Thank you.